Good afternoon, everybody. This is Vijaya Chakravarti here. I'm very happy. This is our 40th webinar, and I'll be talking in place of Malati Rao. Unfortunately, she has not been able to join.
You know, she's had a network issue.
Recently, Malati has attended a webinar where Mrs. Jyoti, who is a science teacher, you know, botany teacher of Tilak International School. This was a webinar for other teachers. And she said there that the IFSA garden is a place where children enjoyed. They brought their children for a field trip here. They enjoyed very much, as well as learned about medicinal plants. The learning garden and the member enrichment program have been appreciated by one and all. Now, I would like to introduce Dr. Maitreyi Paul, you know, who will be giving an introduction to MEP and...
Camera on kijiye, Vijaya ma'am. Recording chal raha hai, koi to dikhe.
Okay. Theek hai. So, I will now invite Dr. Maitreyi Paul to give an introduction of IFSA on this 40th MEP webinar. Maitreyi has graduated in microbiology from Mumbai University, and she's got a postgraduate degree and doctorate in microbiology from the Delhi University. She has been associated with Vivekananda College right from inception in 1979 and was the head of the department of microbiology there till her retirement. Now she is very active, a member of IFSA, and we had the privilege and honor of having her son talk to us about COVID recently. She has mentored students of SIES College. She's now going to mentor the students of Jai Hind College. And she has helped us write a paper. She's done a lot of work in IFSA recently. So over to you, Maitreyi. Thank you.
Thank you, Vijaya, for such a nice introduction. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. At the onset of presentation,
camera on carry lijiye if you
At the onset of presentation, it will be nice to know a little bit about Indian Women Scientists Association. In short, we call IFSA. This is an NGO which was established in 1973 by a dedicated group of 12 women scientists of different faculties to encourage women folk to learn science and take science to masses. Over the years, IFSA, the small seedling, has grown into a big tree with 11 more branches all over India, having headquarters at Vashi, Navi Mumbai. At headquarters, it has developed two distinct wings. One caters to the societal needs of women, involving women's hostel and daycare center, where children from 6 months to 12 years of age are taken care of. Also, there is a kindergarten, preschool, and ECC, that is early childhood care education course, which is affiliated to SNDT University and is run by IFSA. IFSA also gives scholarship to the deserving students from junior college to PhD level in different science faculties. There's a library with a reading room, a computer lab, are some of the sections of this wing. The other wing of IFSA deals with the teaching of science via science awareness program, which conducts classes for children of middle school from economically underprivileged background. It conducts refresher courses for PG students and teachers in collaboration with science academics. Also, it conducts BRNS lectures for college students by eminent speakers in specific fields to give better insight about the topics of their studies and more. The recent development in science awareness is the Learning Garden, in short we call it LG, which gives an in-depth knowledge regarding biodiversity, region-specific endemic plant species, specific flowers and plants catering to butterflies, plants required for puja rituals, their significance, plants producing aromatics, color, medicines, etc., and an arboretum. In fact, it is a living, developed as a living museum for plant bodies, which is a unique feature of Navi Mumbai, where students can have first-hand knowledge about the plant kingdom. However, due to ongoing pandemic situation, these visits have been curtailed. But this situation propelled us to develop a member enrichment program, which is called MEP in short, where members and non-members of IFSA speak about different topics related to plants and other subjects. The other lecture series is the Science and Our Life, that is SAOL, catering to health-related issues. These are meant for broadening the horizon of our knowledge. We also started internship program for college students. Recently, we are also going to start Each One, Teach One, where college students are going to teach the school children. And this is the first we will be going for it. Now, this is the 40th webinar, the last webinar of MEP series. From July onwards, according to Vigyan Prasar, a central government body directive, we will be having garden-based learning, that is GBL webinars, covering many features of flora and fauna for the benefit of members and non-members. Now, I welcome our beloved Dr. Sudha Padia Madam, who is the founder member of IFSA. I am really delighted to introduce Sudha Ma'am. She is a living encyclopedia of rules and regulations of IFSA. Madam lovingly guides both old and new members so that IFSA can be taken to a greater height. You may call her as pathfinder of IFSA. In early years, when Vashi headquarter building did not exist, all the members would meet at her house in Parel. Madam has a motherly touch in all her approaches. Now, I request Sudha Ma'am to release the commemorative booklet of History of MEP and to say a few words to us. Thank you.
Can you see all of you?
Yes.
You can see the booklet?
Yeah.
Yes.
There. Can you see?
Very good. Very nice.
It's upside down.
Very good. Nice it is.
Very nice. I'm really, really, very happy.
Yeah.
Thank you all that you have invited me to release this.
Yeah.
I think I have attended most of these 40 webinars.
Right.
A few are missed, I think. All of you, especially the committee and others, are doing excellent work under simplification of science, spreading of science to the general public. You see, I'm very, very happy and proud that our IFSA seed, which was planted in 73, has grown into a banyan tree. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
All of you have really taken to heart of spreading science, inculcating scientific temper, national thinking, excellence in science, all aspects of the objectives you have taken up. I am really, really very happy. I am sure all my colleagues who are not founder members, who are not with us, you see, they will be watching and they will be also very, very proud that all of you are going in the right direction. And I am sure not only the Golden Jubilee, but even the centenary we will achieve and much more. With number of dedicated members joining, as well as number of associate members who are interested in science joining, it's really, I'm really, really happy. Thank you so much. Thank you. So, this book is, you have compiled, so I'm sure you will compile all the talks also and produce a big book. And keep all these books, send them to the libraries, colleges, and educational institutions and NGOs. See, my interest in science was there from my childhood. My father was a professor in chemistry. But botany and the plants, of course, I used to hear my father talking about Ayurveda. He was interested in the Ayurvedic medicines, all aspects of it. My sister, younger to me, took up botany. So I used to hear all the botanical terms from her. See? It's only now when I joined IVJA that I have come into touch with all other subjects. And it's very, very satisfying that one can get knowledge all round. And in this pandemic, sitting at home, joining the webinars and the Google and the Zoom meets, I'm very, very happy. The only thing is, I'm really a bit worried about is our community-based projects at our complex. I do hope that they will progress. All of you, I'm sure, are taking care and trying to find out how we can get more people. So I'm sure they will also flourish. So don't worry. Our working girls will come, our students will come, our daycare children will come, Balwadi will flourish, everything will happen. Thank you so much. Thank you. Nice to see you all.
Thanks. We are grateful to you, Sudhadi. We are really grateful to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sudha ma'am.
Winnie ma'am.
And for your blessings.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you very much. You know, to see the volume of all the talks. Susan, the talk you gave, and all of you. You see, I can't name. I saw Sujan just now. So it's nice. Huh? I missed Mata Bamji's talk, actually. But others, all of you, Devki, Lalita, Kirti, yes. Bapu,
thank you.
Sunita,
thank you.
All of you. Okay?
Yeah.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bless you.
So happy to be, to have you with us.
Of course, my wish is to see the Golden Jubilee celebration.
She will be always there.
We'll make it a success.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Of course, yes. And the sweet, I enjoy it. So keep on giving me chocolates.
That was Tripta's special thought, ma'am.
Thank you, Padya ma'am. Thank you very much. We always look forward to meet you and to listen to your talk.
Yeah.
To your advices.
I can go on talking, but I have become a bit lazy about writing things now.
Your advices, which are always valuable to all of us. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. I will share a small video with you all.
Yes, Vinny.
Yes,
first slide is visible, right? Okay, I will.
No, not first slide.
Is it?
Presentation started.
Inauguration. Padya ma'am's photograph. Is it there?
Yeah.
Okay, it's moving.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. That's all.
Thank you, Vinnie. So nice. Very nice.
Thank you,
Vinnie. Very, very nice display. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Malati ma'am, please take over.
Okay. Thank you very much, ma'am. It was lovely to see you and very lovely to hear you. And Vinnie and Suparna, beautiful presentation. You know, I'm simply in love with that presentation. And Tripta, thank you for sending the chocolates to ma'am. You know, that was very nice. She is very happy. And because she is happy, all of us are happy. Thank you, Tripta. Okay. Now, and thank you, Maitreyi. You've done a beautiful job at the introduction. Thank you very much.
Welcome. So,
now we move on to today's topic. Our topic for today is plant-based food to boost our immunity. And the speaker is Madam Supriya Bose. Supriya, Madam, is a graduate of Mumbai University with chemistry as a major subject. She did her postgraduate diploma in dietetics and applied nutrition from Mumbai University itself. She worked as a senior dietitian for over 26 years in Kasturba Hospital for Infectious Diseases in Mumbai University. At present, she does freelance consultancy and follows her passion of dancing, being an expert in several dance forms. Probably we should invite her one day to perform, you know, or show us her dances, you know, the different dance styles. She's also another thing, very, very important. She's also an ex-student of our beloved Sri Rupa Mukherjee. Dr. Sri Rupa Mukherjee is her ex-student. I would like to now request the audience to share your queries in the chat box and keep your videos and audios on mute. Welcome, ma'am. Please take over and start your talk.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Vijay Madam. And a very good afternoon to all of you. First of all, I will take this opportunity to congratulate the members of IWSA on their noble endeavor of spreading science awareness, and on this 40th webinar as well. And I will also thank you for giving me this opportunity, and also Dr. Sri Rupa Mukherjee for giving me this opportunity to speak to a learned community like you. I will start my presentation.
The NEPs have brought our families together, you know. All webinars are a collaborative effort with husbands and grandchildren and children and everyone. This is wonderful.
Are you able to see this? Are you able to see the screen? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. We can see your screen.
Yes. Yes, yes.
So today my topic is about plant-based and vegetarian foods that strengthen our immunity. Now, during this pandemic, this subject has acquired a lot of importance and urgency. And in a way, we have to thank our experience in this situation that all of us have realized the importance of this aspect as well. Now, immunity varies on various factors. And I think one of the primary ones are healthy eating habits and a healthy lifestyle. So today I'll be talking about the various nutrients that goes into strengthening and boosting our immunity. As you see, our immune system, it's a unique system. I mean, it is a unique system, but it's a very efficient and very complicated one. And this is the system that keeps us alive, in fact, because we are constantly bombarded by so many pathogens like viruses, bacteria, toxins. In spite of that, this is the system that is protecting us from the attack of all these things. I would
just a second.
Sorry. Yes. And so now, nutrition I think plays a very pivotal role in the functioning as well as the strengthening of the system. So let us see the various categories of nutrients that are involved in this system. The broad two categories are the micronutrients and the macronutrients. The micronutrients are the nutrients which are required in very small amounts, but even then they are very, very essential for the functioning of the immune system. And the macronutrients are required in comparatively larger amounts. Under the micronutrients, we have the vitamins, minerals, and the essential fatty acids. In the vitamins categories, we have vitamin A, vitamin B, C, D, and E. Vitamin A, B, and D, I would say they play a very distinct role. I mean, they specific role in the immune system, whereas vitamin C and vitamin E, they play the role of the antioxidants. The minerals, we have iron, calcium, magnesium, manganese, zinc, phosphorus, selenium, etc. These minerals are mainly parts of the coenzymes that take part in the immune system. And the essential fatty acids, these are the polyunsaturated fatty acids, and they have the property of anti-inflammatory action. They are very strong anti-inflammatory agents, and so they are very, very important for our immune system. Under the macronutrients is the proteins. As you know, the proteins are the building blocks of every tissue in our body. So the immune cells also depend on proteins. Proteins are immensely important as well for our immune system. Now let us see the categories of food from where we derive these nutrients. I have classified the foods that we normally take to vegetables, fruits, nuts, seeds, protein-rich foods, and millets. Now, from each of these categories, I have selected a few foods which I think have an exceptionally good nutritional profile, and they are locally grown, they are locally available, and they are pocket-friendly. So we can include them easily in our daily diets. Now, whenever we talk about immunity, and the first thing that comes to our mind is lots of fruits and vegetables, colored fruits and vegetables. Yes, they are the best source of vitamins, minerals, antioxidants, fibers, say what. So first we come to the vegetable section. From the vegetable section, let us see the star fruits. Now these foods, we can also call them as local superfoods. First we come to spinach. Spinach is an excellent source of vitamin A, vitamin C, folate, all the minerals like calcium, magnesium, iron, vitamin K, and it is an extremely strong antioxidant. And it has a lot of fiber also. So you can see it has got all the potent things required for a strong immune system. Same with broccoli. Broccoli is a powerhouse of antioxidants. It has got very powerful antioxidants with glutathione and vitamin A and vitamin C and vitamin E as well. Third is carrots. Carrots are the brightly colored orange vegetables, and they are extremely rich in the beta carotenes, that is again a very good antioxidant apart from vitamin A and vitamin B also. The fourth vegetable that I consider is capsicum. Capsicums are very rich in vitamin C, especially the colored capsicums. And they are also contain a lot of beta carotenes, so they are very good antioxidants again. They are rich in fiber also. All vegetables are rich in fiber. So you see, all these vegetables are locally available practically throughout the season. They are available, so they should be included in our diet, and they should be a part of our diet as much as possible. So this will definitely help to build a strong immune. In other section of vegetables, mushrooms. Mushrooms, they come into the fungi category actually. They belong to the fungi family, but they are eaten as vegetables. They are also known for their high antioxidant properties. At the same time, they contain these minerals like selenium, copper, magnesium, phosphorus. They have fiber also, and they are a moderate source of protein all the vegetables. Mushrooms are not very commonly used, as I know, but they should be, I mean, it should be tried. Many people do not eat mushrooms. They have not tried mushrooms, but then because of their high nutritive value and high antioxidant properties in these times of immunity, boosting our immunity, we should try and start accepting mushroom as a part of our diet. It is a tasty, it doesn't have much flavor of its own. It acquires the flavor of the curry that you prepare, and it has got a very nice texture. So I think it should be included in our diet. Next is sweet potatoes. Sweet potatoes are another highly nutritious roots. They come in various colors, like maybe light orangish, reddish, pinkish, and even dark purplish. And they are very good source of antioxidants. They contain selenium also. So, you know, that is also a very important mineral required for our immune system. So these vegetables, this root vegetable also should be included as often as possible. The third thing is moringa. Moringa tree is our own drumstick tree. Now, moringa tree is a very interesting tree. The moringa pods, that is the drumsticks that we usually consume, they are very big sources of calcium and vitamin C. The interesting part is the moringa leaves. They are huge source, storehouse of antioxidants. And it is said that they contain about 46 types of antioxidants. Now, moringa leaves are not so commonly used. I mean, in the southern parts of India, I've heard they use it as like any other normal leafy vegetables. But in many other parts of our country, I don't think they consume moringa leaves that way. So I think we should try and incorporate that also in our diets. And you can put them in the dal, you can add it to some vegetables, and maybe we can try them out in parathas or things like that. So these things also will definitely, adding these sort of things in our diet will definitely give a boost to our immune system. Moringa flowers also, I have heard that since ages they have been used as healing agents. So this is a very powerful tree. Now, moringa tree is widely available in our country, in our localities. So whenever we get the opportunity, whenever they are in season, I think we should make the best use of it. And I think you all must have heard that moringa leaves are powdered and packeted in bottles and capsules and sold in the Western countries as antioxidant supplements. But that way, I think we are lucky. We have so many moringa trees all around us, and I think we should try to make the best. Next is the vegetables, and that is rather they are more used as condiments. Garlic, ginger, and turmeric. These things form a very integral part of every Indian kitchen. Garlic, in fact, is used by a world over as a flavoring agent. And garlic has been known since ages for its medicinal properties. It is said to be, it's an elixir of health. And garlic contains a lot of sulfur. And so these sulfur compounds in garlic helps it to give this medicinal properties of antibacterial, antifungal. And it has been used for common cold and flu since ages, garlic has been used. And I have also read somewhere that it has been used during the First and the Second World Wars also for wounded soldiers so that they wouldn't land up with gangrene. So you can imagine such strong and antibacterial properties this garlic has. We should, so we are lucky, we use garlic in our daily diet, in our cooking, in the Indian cooking, garlic is very much consumed. So that is not an issue, but if we have to get the maximum medical benefits, medicinal benefits out of garlic, I think we should consume it in the raw form. That is the best form of consuming garlic. Just crush 2-3 cloves of garlic and have it on an empty stomach. Or you can also put the raw garlics in chutneys and all, that will also be a good source of getting the nutrition. Next is ginger. Ginger is a very strong anti-inflammatory root. this also we know since ages, we know ginger as an anti-inflammatory agent, because it is to be used for sore throats, sore stomach aches, pains of arthritis, and many pain relieving things ginger has been used. We are lucky Indians use a lot of ginger in our cooking, so that is good. So consuming ginger is not an issue with us. And for the medicinal benefits, we can consume ginger in the raw form, in the form of its juice, by extracting, just crushing some ginger, getting 3-4 tablespoons of juice in a day. It's very good for immunity. Or we can have ginger karas, ginger teas. And so third is turmeric. Turmeric is also another excellent anti-inflammatory and antioxidant agent. It is because of the component called curcumin in turmeric that it gets all these properties. Indians, we use plenty of turmeric in all our cooking, so that is good for us. And turmeric also, just plain consuming plain turmeric, it is not, you don't get much bioavailability is less. So turmeric is actually supposed to be consumed along with some fat. Then it is the bioavailability is much more. So I think it is this age-old wisdom that has introduced turmeric into our Indian cooking. Like we put it in the tadkas, we put it in the curries. So it is always taken along with some fat, and we are able to get the benefits of turmeric. Now, before coming to fruits, I will say that you will be wanting to know that how much of vegetables should be consumed in a day. Now, the amount of vegetables and fruits combined, in a day, we have to consume, say, around about 5 to 6 servings. One serving is equal to, say, a medium cup of raw vegetable or raw fruit, and half a cup of medium cooked vegetable is one serving. So combining all these fruits and vegetables, we should be taking at least about 5 to 6 servings in a day, and that will be giving us sufficient nutrient for our immunity. And so we must try to include as much vegetables. I have just talked about a handful of vegetables. All the vegetables are containing these antioxidant properties. They have lots of vitamins. So we must always try to include the seasonal ones, the colorful ones, and a variety of them in our daily diets. Now, coming to fruits, the first thing that comes when you talk about immunity are the citrus fruits. They are excellent sources of vitamin C. Along with that, they have minerals like phosphorus, magnesium, copper, and they are huge sources of anti-inflammatory and antioxidants. They have contain a lot of fiber as well. And it is said if you consume, it is proved that if you consume sufficient amount of vitamin C, then your period of infection is much reduced. And vitamin C, as you all know, is not stored in our body. So we have to take a daily dose of vitamin C in our diets in some form or the other. And citrus fruits are very widely available. There are a huge variety of citrus fruits like lime, lemon, oranges, sweet lime, tangerines, mandarins, grapefruits, etc. There are various local citrus fruits also. So throughout the year, citrus fruits are available in some form or the other. So we must include at least 1 or 2 citrus fruits per day in our diet. So this will definitely enhance our immunity. Next, coming to amla, as you all know, amla is a storehouse of vitamin C, amla or Indian gooseberry. This is the highest content of vitamin C, and whenever it is a seasonal fruit, of course, so whenever it is available, we must make the best of it. I mean, the best way of consuming amla will be consuming 1 raw amla, but that may not always be possible. So maybe we can get a fresh juice out of 2-3 amla and consume it, or steam the amla and consume it. And in season when amla is not available, we should preserve this amla in the form of pickles or murabbas or dried suparis. So that will also give us sufficient vitamin C throughout the year. next we come to guava. Guava is a superfood, I would say. It is also an extremely good source of vitamin C, fiber, along with iron. And guava is also another seasonal fruit. So whenever it is in season, you must consume as much guava as you can and make it a part of your daily diet. Papaya. Papaya is an excellent fruit. I mean, it is a brilliant fruit, I would say. It's available throughout the season. Absolutely rich in vitamin A, vitamin C, folates, a lot of fiber. And papaya also contains an enzyme called papain, which helps to break down the complicated protein chains in our stomach. So, you know, it is, in a way, it is a very good digestive agent. So papaya is available throughout the season and everywhere, all over India, papaya is available. So it is not an issue consuming, making it a part of our diet on a daily basis. Pomegranate, this is another wonderful fruit packed with anti-inflammatory and antioxidant properties. And it is also rich in vitamin C, vitamin E, and contains a lot of potassium. Now, pomegranate juice is very, very useful for convalescing patients. It reduces the period of convalescence. It has got very good antioxidant properties. So pomegranate also is available more or less throughout the season. So we must consume it on a regular basis whenever it is available. Then strawberries. Strawberries, berries in general, I will tell you, they are another powerhouse of antioxidants. And they contain anthocyanins because of the bright colors they have. We have a variety of berries like blueberries, raspberries, mulberries, strawberries. But you know, berries are very local. I mean, you don't get all the berries everywhere. In Mumbai, we are fortunate to have a long season of strawberries. So I think whenever berries, strawberries are in season in Mumbai, we must consume it as much as we can because it is a very good antioxidant. It definitely uplifts our immunity. See, apart from these, I am talking on the immunity aspect of these foods. Apart from these, they have many other properties also. They are very heart friendly. They help to reduce cholesterol and things like that. Then we come to dates. Dates are rather classified under dry fruits. They are very delicious fruits, and they are also another excellent source of nutrients. They contain a lot of vitamin B6, which helps in the manufacturing of red blood cells. They are rich in iron, and they are also very high in antioxidants and fiber. The dates are available throughout the year. So I think dates should form a part of our daily diet. This also will keep our immunity strong and robust. Nuts. Nuts are, they are very concentrated sources of nutrition. They're packed with proteins, fats, good fats, and a lot of micronutrients and good omega acids, that is the omega-3 fatty acids. All the nuts, in fact, they contain more or less the same amount of vitamin E, magnesium, calcium, phosphorus, and omega-3. Walnut is extremely rich in omega-3. And groundnut is extremely rich in all the B vitamins that are in the whole range of B vitamins we can get from groundnuts. Plus, they have zinc. So all these factors, as you can see, cashew nuts are also very rich in zinc, and almonds are very rich in omega-3. So as you can see, nuts in general are really immunity boosters. So nuts, actually, it is very good. These nuts are locally available throughout the year. So nuts, in fact, if we can have it on a regular basis, it will be excellent for our immunity. And how much of nuts should we have? Maybe about 40 to 45 grams. I mean, people who are actually watching out for their weight should not have much of these nuts. They have fat, so they can add to your weight. So for the immunity purpose, just a handful of nuts in a day, you can mix the nuts and apple, that will be sufficient. Now these nuts like almonds and peanuts, they have some anti-nutrient factors called phytates, which prevents the absorption of these micronutrients, these minerals, etc., zinc and calcium and magnesium. So these nuts, it is best to have them after soaking them or mild roasting them. Then you will get rid of those phytonutrients and you can have them come. Seeds. Seeds are also very good sources of protein. Apart from that, they are also, again, very concentrated source of these micronutrients, rich in micronutrients. All the seeds, as you can see, the flax seeds, sesame seeds, we have chia seeds, the pumpkin seeds, and the sunflower seeds are taken. All these seeds are very rich in the minerals like magnesium, calcium, zinc, selenium also some of them have, phosphorus, iron, vitamins like vitamin, all the ranges of vitamin B actually they contain, and they are full of what I will say, omega-3 fatty acids. They're very rich in omega-3 fatty acids. So these seeds also, I think, should form a part of your daily diet. You should, every day you should be consuming these seeds in some form or the other. I mean, they can be just roasted and had as a small snack, or they can be powdered and spread over your salad, your raita, or you can also include them in your gravies. They have a nutty flavor. Or you can make a smoothie out of them, out of these seeds. So it is very easy to have them, and these seeds are very locally available. So I think we should include them in our daily diet. It's a great, great immunity system. Now coming to proteins, we had just seen that proteins are very much, they form an important part of the nutrients required for boosting our immunity. Now these are the protein sources that I've selected for the vegetarians. They're extremely rich in fiber, minerals, and antioxidants as well. Chickpeas or kabuli chana, lobia, rajma, soybean chunks are also available. So all these options are there for vegetarians to include in their diet for, as a source of protein. Now these should be taken on a daily basis, because protein also is not stored in our body. So protein, we have to supply the protein requirement on a daily basis. So it is important that we consume these legumes on a daily basis. Now these legumes also are having these anti-nutrient factor, that is this phytate factor. So fortunately, we do not take them raw, and we soak them and boil them, so that soaking process also get rid, we can get rid of the anti-nutrient factor. Soya bean, I would particularly like to mention, soya bean also is a very good protein, quality protein, in the sense it contains all the 9 essential amino acids. The other legumes or dals, they may be deficient in some of the amino acids. So that makes them not an incomplete, but not a very high quality protein. But soya bean is a complete protein. So soya bean, we can consume in the form of soya bean atta by supplementing in our attas. We normally do that. And soya bean chunks as well. They also will give you a lot of fiber. We can use delicious curries and pulao or things like that that can be prepared with soya bean chunks. So these legumes are excellent sources of antioxidants as well. So they give a huge boost, along with the protein content and the antioxidant content. They give a huge boost to our immune system. Dal. Dal forms an integral part of our Indian diet. So there are various types of dals locally available. Masoor dal, moong, chana dal, urad dal. We should have a variety of them. They are also good sources of antioxidants, minerals, good source of protein. All these legumes and dals, they can give you around 24 to 30 grams of protein per 100 grams. So that much protein content they have. So they should form an integral part of our diet on a daily basis. Another thing I forgot to mention is, as I had told you, dal and legumes, they are deficient in some of the amino acids, that is mainly they are deficient in methionine. So whenever they are combined with a cereal, like rice or roti, so the quality, they complement each other, and the quality of the protein improves. the deficiency of amino acid methionine in the legumes and dal is compensated by the cereal. So it, this combination again is an age-old combination. It is not new. We have been having this in this combination, dal rice, rajma rice, chana with roti and things like that. So it then the protein quality is improved. So we should consume it in that way. It is age-old wisdom, of course. The other source of protein, this is not plant-based, of course, but this is an excellent source of protein. It is the milk protein. Milk protein is also another complete protein which contains all the essential amino acids. Milk products like paneer, curds, they give you a good amount of protein. Maybe one glass of milk about will give you around 7 to 8 grams of protein, whereas 100 grams of paneer can give you about 14 grams of protein. About a katori of curds will give you another 7 grams of protein. So you see, milk is a very good quantity of protein, and for a vegetarian, these milk in these forms should form a part of your daily diet. And I would suggest, like for people who are looking out for their weight, it is it will be great if you can prepare the paneer at home with a low-fat milk. Then you get the percentage of protein also, you will get more, and the fat percentage will be less. That will be much healthier for you. Same with curds also. So that depends. The millets. Millet is another group of cereals, like the small round cereals. They belong to the grass family. Actually, they are also starchy like normal cereals like wheat and rice, etc. But I will say, since last few years, we were not given their right position, right status as a cereal, as a staple cereal in our Indian diet. Locally, of course, these millets were being consumed. But like how commonly we consume rice, wheat and things like that. Maize, millets are not consumed like that. But since last few years, a lot of research has gone into this, and millets have been proved to be exceptionally nutritious. They are very good sources of micronutrients, very rich in micronutrients, and they contain a lot of polyphenols, due to which they have very good antioxidant properties, which are again not there in normal rice and wheat. So when we compare rice and wheat to millets, I mean, the millets will get more marks because of their high micronutrient content. And that's why consumption of these millets will definitely help to boost our immunity. And the added advantage is that these are gluten-free. So people who have gluten allergy or severe diseases, they can easily consume these millets. And they have low glycemic index also. So for diabetics also, these millets are an excellent substitute for rice or wheat. So we will just be going through the common millets and selected. This Rajgira, Zamaran. Rajgira is very rich in iron also. And we can call it, it is having sufficient protein also. So we can call it a substitute for and call it a substitute of quinoa. It is an Indian quinoa, I would say. Sorghum is jawar. Jawar is widely used in Maharashtra, Gujarat, and some parts of central parts of India. Jawar is also a very good millet, containing a lot of micronutrients like calcium, magnesium, the phosphorus, iron. Pearl millet is bajra. This is also widely consumed in the Maharashtra and Gujarat, etc. Bajra is another millet which is very rich in calcium. And finger millet, ragi, I think it is consumed more in the southern parts of India. It is an excellent source of calcium. So if you have calcium deficiency, we must definitely make ragi a part of our daily diet. Now these millets, again, they have this anti-nutrient factor in them, so before consuming them, they have to be soaked, or they have to be fermented. So there are various recipes available on these millets. Like you can prepare dosa, you can have them in the form of soft idlis, you can have them in the form of khichdi, like how we prepare dalia. upma, things like that. Now we have to, I think we should start getting used to this, these millets, and it will be an excellent idea if we could replace one meal with millets instead of the regular cereals that we take, like poha, rice, things like that. We could include these millets. These will give an excellent boost to our immunity. The other millets example are barnyard millets. It's called sanwa. They also come like small rice. Foxtail millet, it's called kangani. I mean, it's very much used in the southern parts of India. Kuttu is a buckwheat, it's called buckwheat millet. It is made into an atta, and I think it is used normally in the northern parts of India. I have not seen this millet. So, you know, there are various types of millets. Millets are also local. So there are, I think, various varieties. I have not seen. I have just brought to you the local varieties that are available so that we can use them in our diet. Now, I have spoken about the nutrition part, the nutrients required for a good immunity to be strengthened and boosted. But then good immunity cannot happen without a good gut, without a healthy gut. So as you know, there are trillions of bacteria in our microorganisms in our body. Out of that, most of them are in the intestines, are found in the intestines. Most of them are healthy ones, which help us in digestion, in absorption, and in the immunity activity. They play a very important role in our immunity. So it is our job to preserve these microflora in our guts so that we have a healthy gut. So we have to consume probiotics on a daily basis, and that will help our guts. Probiotics are the living microbes that we can supplement to the gut, that is in the form of curds, in the form of fermented foods. And it is also said in the, there are various probiotics, Indian probiotics are there, locally used, even achars for that matter, pickles, I mean, are said to be probiotics, the ones which are homemade and which have been kept in the sun for 1 or 2 weeks to ferment, and then they are used throughout the year. They also act as probiotics. Of course, nowadays we don't eat so much of pickles because of the salt and the oil in them. But then I just mentioned that they also could act as probiotics. So it is very important that we have a probiotic in our diet on a daily basis. Prebiotics are the food for the microbes in the gut. So they come from the fiber that we eat. So if we are taking sufficient fiber from the vegetables, from the fruits, from the whole grains that we consume, those fibers are again converted into prebiotics by the bacteria themselves and used as food. So prebiotics separately, we don't have to think about it, as long as we are taking a balanced diet with lot of fiber. So now this was one aspect of immunity. Now immunity has the other factors also. Like it is apart from healthy food habits, it is exercise, adequate sleep, reducing your stress, and these things I will say we have sort of personal basis, but we have to take it very seriously and really work upon these factors. Coming back to healthy food habits, I will say that at least we must avoid eating junk foods as much as possible, fast foods as much as possible, and try to absolutely avoid the refined packed food, packaged foods, and always prioritize home food over outside food. So that automatically will lead to a healthy food habit. Now, a healthy food habit combined with a good lifestyle gives a good immunity, but this comes over a period of time. It is like, you know, preparing an army for a battle. So whenever there is an invasion, the army has to be fit and ready to overcome the invasion of bacteria, germs, or whatever it is from outside. So it is a lifestyle. So we have to keep on doing it. Immunity doesn't come in one day. So we really have to work on it. So that is, in a nutshell, I will say that if we have a healthy, balanced diet, consisting of the seasonal fruits, seasonal vegetables in sufficient quantity, along with sufficient amount of proteins and nuts, seeds, which contain huge amount of micronutrients and providing a good amount of probiotics to our gut, we are bound to have a very good immune system, which will take us far beyond the maybe coronavirus. We can overcome that way. So thank you for giving me a patient hearing, and wish you all the best.